Hello and welcome to Friends of the Force, a Star Wars podcast. I'm your host, Brad.
And I'm your host, Sarah.
And this week on the show, we are talking about the Bad Batch episodes number 7 and 8, which are the Clone Conspiracy and Truth and Consequences. We got a double feature again, which is really exciting. Last time was the premiere episode. So we kind of had a feeling that this was going to be a big one, you know, like having a mid-season two-parter. And I will say, we were not disappointed.
It was a big one.
Wow. Yeah. There's a lot here to discuss.
Yeah. And also up front, I just want to apologize if I start talking and then like it comes out as like a breathy, slight cough. I'm getting over COVID again.
COVID has returned.
I'm so pissed about it. I'm really mad. It's fine. But just an apologies to the listeners, apologies to your ears. I'm gonna do my best. But I'm feeling good now, so that's good.
There are no apologies needed on this podcast. We just hope you get better. Feel better.
Thanks.
Drink lots of water.
Yep.
And consume lots of books. Well, actually, don't strain yourself too much, but like in doses, you know, like piecemeal. Enjoy yourself. Treat yourself is what I'm trying to say.
To books?
Yeah. Or BTS. Whatever makes you happy. You got to take it easy.
Yes and yes. Yes and yes to that. I've been reading, what was it? Mistakes Were Made by Meryl Wilson right now. Wow. Oh. If you know, you know. If you don't, wow. It's very steamy. It's kind of hilarious. Anyway.
Let me tell you, there were a lot of mistakes made in these episodes of The Bad Batch.
Wow.
Particularly.
You are so good at this.
Particularly. By Admiral Rampart. Hashtag canceled. Hashtag Admiral Rampart is over party. Hashtag canceled. Hashtag suck it. Hashtag jail time. Spoilers ahead.
Yeah, if that didn't already say it. These two episodes, I think I speak for both of us when I say that they really took us on a journey that we were not quite expecting. And then when we got there, I wish I had screenshotted it. It was you and me. And we just were like, mouth open. Shock.
These two episodes had me so shook, but specifically the end of Truth and Consequences, when the floor of the Senate chamber opens up and I'm like, okay, this is it. This is the moment, right? Because we see the trailer at Celebration. There are so many question marks that we had coming out of that panel, because we're like, what? Like, Palpatine's back. Why is Omega in the Senate chamber? Like, is this an illusion? Like, is this like a vision of some sort? Like, what's going on? Like, there's a hologram in the background. And like, we had no idea what was about to happen. And then like, pieces start coming together and we're like, oh God, like the big man is back in the house, back from whatever sort of Sith journeys or Sith missions that he's been on with Vader potentially. Like, you know, he's out and about. Maas Ameda is in his stead for the most part, it seems like, you know. And some of the senators even poke fun at that, like, you know, hey, you're his representative. Like, where is he? You know, he's doing bad stuff.
Bad stuff, for sure. I love how at the end of Truth and Consequences, we really got both the truth and the consequences.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. But I think we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves here, because I think we should talk. I have a thought. I walked away from these two episodes with a thought, and I think I just need to bring it up and say it, and then we can move forward into the episodes. Are you ready for it?
Yeah.
Why does this show have some of its best moments when the Batch is not around?
That is a question that I have been asking since the Ryloth arc. And it's not to say that like the Batch themselves aren't interesting or aren't great characters, because like they are. We love each of the Bad Batch members. Like, they are near and dear to our hearts. But it is interesting when we see some of these bigger, more mature storylines at play. You know, we have like the episode 3 of this season, which was really great and featured Crosshair and some pretty heavy stuff. And then I feel like this was getting back towards that with the Clone Conspiracy. And I was like, oh gosh, there's like really some like political meat here. There's some substance. There's some kind of larger galactic stakes happening. And that's really exciting, because I think this time period is so unique and we really haven't seen this time period from that point of view before. Like, it's been, you know, a lot of side stories that are happening on the periphery. And then, you know, this episode and these two episodes, and I feel like, you know, we haven't watched the next couple, but I feel like we're going to go back to like a mission of the week again. And that's like my kind of, that's like my concern going into next episode is like, are we going to kind of diverge away from that path of greatness and like these really killer moments that the show has? And not to say anything is filler, because I strongly don't believe that, but I wish that the Bad Batch were more consistently like woven into some of these storylines. Cause I do think they were featured like really well with Truth and Consequence. I thought their raid on the Venator was really exciting and really thrilling and had me gripping my seat. Like I was like, oh my gosh, how are they going to get out of this? This is scary. This is exciting. This is pumping my adrenaline.
When those engines turn on, you're like, what?
Yeah. And then, you know, Echo comes to his sort of realization that there is a larger purpose for him, and he decides to leave the group. And that's really powerful and actually like had me in tear, like literal tears. I was tearing up with how powerful that was, because he's been sort of foreshadowing that all season. And I just wish a sort of like these sort of powerful moments and standout moments were more consistent. You know, with those doses of fun, it's kind of spaced in between everything.
Yeah, I mean, we're definitely, I agree with you. Like, I'm not here to say that the episodes that we have gotten before, like the few episodes in between episode 3 and this one, are filler, because they are not. You know, they had valuable themes and ideas and characters that kind of wove through those stories for 100%. Sure. And I think overall we enjoy those episodes, but they're definitely more mission of the week style, which is different than like the capital P plot that we're getting in episode 3 and in these two episodes. And it's interesting to me how different these episodes feel from one another, if that makes sense. And I'm not sure if it's like the team behind the Bad Batch wrestling with the demographic that they're going towards, or if they're wrestling with like the medium and the episode formatting. But I don't know. I just feel a little bit unsettled about it, because I feel like we have this moments of like, holy crap, this is really amazing. And then we go immediately back to something where I'm like, I'm not sure where this is getting us with these characters. And I guess, you know, time will tell to see how it continues to unfold over the, you know, the back half of the season. But I'm hoping for more great moments and great moments with the Batch, because I agree with you, Brad, like they are good characters and they're interesting and they have stories to tell. And, you know, when I say this, I kind of take Omega out of the equation, because I can think of some really great Omega moments. She's truly the heart and the spirit of the Batch. Like in, you know, the very early episodes when she is out on the ground and she's like touching dirt for the first time. That's just a moment that rings really loudly in my mind and my memory about this show. But I want the Batch themselves to play more into the capital P plot. I want the show to have a clearer sense of, you know, why the Batch is the title of the show and like where we're going with them specifically and not just within the galaxy.
And hopefully Echo is a step towards that, right? Because Rex is back in the picture, which I was so excited to see Rex emerge
like,
from the
who
smoke.
Who is it? Who is it?
Rescue Rex? The senator, you know, that was so, I thought it was going to be Cody maybe, and Cody was already establishing some back networks, but having Rex back was so, so exciting. But I do think like Echo is getting towards like what you're wanting, and what I want is like what is the Bad Batch's larger purpose. And I think it should be to help clones and to liberate clones and to you know, on a mass scale, remove chips and give them back their freedom that they never really had in the first place, or that they didn't have since the Clone War. I mean, they had some sense of freedom in the Clone Wars, that they had identity.
Right.
And they had a little bit more free will, and that was all stripped away from them with Order 66. So like that to me seems like a compelling purpose. And that's why I think I got so emotional with Echo, was because I was like, oh, he's finding that finally. Like one member of the Batch is finding that, and I hope that the rest of them can. And I think like what you're saying, I think we're going a little bit more at a snail's pace. Not that anything is filler, because I, again, strongly believe every episode has had its shining moment in like character development, especially with Tech this season, I think has been really powerful. But I want more of the larger narrative at play each and every episode. Like, we still haven't had Crosshair since episode 3. He's been in 1 out of 8 episodes so far, which is a bit alarming to me. And I think that like he's a critical member of the batch, but we're not really seeing his point of view, which is sort of the TAM problem of Star Wars Resistance season 2, which is like, we didn't see a lot of TAM except for a couple episodes. And right. She was on the opposite side.
Right. And I think the problem I have, I like where Echo is going. And I agree with you that like, it seems like he's finding his purpose and kind of really committing to that, even if it means being apart from the batch for a while. But I wonder how, you know, I wonder if it means he's going to be written out for a time from the show, just because I don't feel like this show has fully successfully handled all of the separate narratives. I was really expecting Crosshair to be a central figure of these two episodes. I think I mentioned that one of our earlier episodes. I was like, oh, episode 3, I think he's going to come back in 7 and 8 and kind of play a big role there. And I'm just surprised that that's not quite how that played out. And it makes me wonder, as you mentioned, like what's he up to? Because he is a key member of the batch and also a bit of an antagonist, at least in season 1, for you know, our crew, because of the relationship that they had. And I think that the push and pull of that when we got that in season 1 was also really thrilling. And you know, you and I both love that sort of relationship where it's like, he could redeem himself. He could bring himself back to the light. They would love him and accept him still, you know, and that's a storyline that I really gravitate towards. And so them not having any sort of push and pull between Crosshair and the rest of the team is interesting to me. And then also now having Echo. So there's like 3 points of the Bad Batch. And then we also have like the political thing. And then also there's Cid and how Cid interacts with our 2 points of the Bad Batch, but maybe now just 1, since the Echo's, you know, off and running. Also how Cid minorly interacts with the politics, but not really, because she exists in a different space. So there's like a lot of elements going on. And I really like these episodes, but I find myself halfway through the season going, what's the goal? What's the goal for the batch? And that's, I mean, as you just mentioned, something I think we're still trying to figure out. So I don't know. It's one of those things where I'm just thinking about it. Obviously, yeah. As we've talked about it now for like 10 minutes.
And I want to make clear too, like, and you said it, we enjoyed the hell out of these episodes.
Like
we were very, very happy.
Enthralled.
We want the show to be at its best. And I think like these 2 episodes, as well as the Solitary Clone episode 3, I think those are like the Bad Batch at its best. I think because it's grappling with these ideas of what is a clone's purpose? You know, to what extent like will a clone follow an order, right? Where is the lines in the sand drawn? When is too far, right? Kamino, the answer here is that Kamino was the line. It's the line too far, because now the clones are starting to go AWOL. They're starting to question what's being asked of them. We're dealing with what happens to veterans. Like, what happens to veterans in the aftermath of a war where they're no longer needed in society? Do we find them a purpose, a new order that they can kind of follow? Or do we discard them and throw them on the street? And we see in the Kenobi series, Obi-Wan Kenobi has a run-in with a clone commander holding out his helmet, you know, Temuera Morrison all dressed up, holding out a helmet and saying, you know, spare change for a veteran, or however he says it, right? So like that's like what's going to be the clones' reality. You know, at least the ones who aren't liberated and find a new life, but this is how the Empire treats clones. And we herald in a new age of Stormtrooper, which we'll get into, but like, I think that sort of those sorts of topics are really interesting, and I wish the show talked about even more, because it's just like, yeah, that makes so much sense. Like, this would be a huge question, like, hanging over this entire time period, is like, what happens to this army, and like, where do they go after this?
Right. It's the idea of like self-determination and like being able to pave your own path. And, you know, for all of their lives thus far, the clones have been on a path, on a road that's been built for them, and it's crumbling before their eyes. And some of them are really seeing that road crumble and are wondering, like, where do I take my next step? And those themes, I think, are like the themes of identity and paving your own path. I think those are really valuable and heavy topics too, especially within the context they're being talked about with veterans. You know, like, there's a mention by Chuchi of pensions in these episodes. Like, that's not for an 8-year-old, you know, like these political ideas that are being talked about in these two episodes are really quite serious. And I think that's so interesting because I think they get talked about with a lot of respect and maturity and seriousness in these two episodes. And I don't know if I quite expected that, but let's talk about the Senate chamber and us walking into the Senate chamber as viewers. Of course, we're not really there.
Man.
We're real and not animated. And we find the senators discussing Kamino and what happened there, and that's the reason why they're considering the defense recruitment bill, which is essentially you know, the being conscription bill as opposed to, you know, clones, because they can't create any more clones,
right? And an army comprised of the people for the people, as one of the senators puts it.
It's really quite a statement, isn't it?
Yeah, really on the nose.
I find myself not one who is find themselves enthralled with the idea of military in the first place. So I'm not saying there's one option that's good or one option that's bad. I think they're both kind of bad, but like, whoo.
Well, there's a lot layered in that too, because it's like one comprised of the people. I mean, that just goes to show that these senators don't consider the clones people.
Right.
They strip them of their humanity.
There is a very clear idea that the Senate and the galaxy have completely discarded the clones and do not see their autonomy and do not see their, you know, individuality. And I think that that also speaks to a lot of different marginalized groups, you know, within society, and the ways that they're all grouped into one label, and the ways that that label is used to be reductive and ultimately further discard or oppress marginalized identities. So I thought that was really heavy topic, and an important one. But also, I just want to talk a little bit about the cameos that we get. So ultimately, Chuchi becomes a big part of these two episodes. She's kind of the main spokesperson for the clones in these two episodes, and I believe she's from the Clone Wars. Am I right on that?
Yes. Yeah, so she's in several episodes of the Clone Wars, which, like, immediately when she popped up, I had recognized her. But yeah, she's featured Ryo Chuchi. So she's from the moon of Pantora. So it's kind of it's exciting to see, like, some of these senators from the Clone Wars now making their way on the big stage.
The big stage being the Bad Batch, like, obviously.
You know, like, continuing some of their stories and, like, having even larger purposes for them is always a good thing, because, like, it kind of builds a sort of, like, animated universe out even more, which I always love. Like, that's why I love the crossover sometimes with Rebels and Clone Wars. Like, that's always exciting.
Well, I mean, it also, in these sorts of cases, gives a sense of continuity for minor characters as well. Like, hey,
yeah,
you know, we didn't get a whole new crop of senators. Like, some people are still here. And one of the people that we know will continue on from this series into live action is Senator Palmo, played by Sharon Duncan Brewster, who is the senator from Rogue One, the gorgeous senator from Rogue One. And her voice is like, it's like butter. Like, oh, it's yeah, so delicious.
And Sharon and Duncan Brewster is the actress in yes, Rogue One as well. So like, in yeah, case you're a listener, you're wondering, they brought back the real deal. I was not expecting that.
Like, I had my hands in the air. I was like, wow. Yes.
Wow. And you know, who knows? That might not be the last that we see of her. I
no
mean,
way.
It's very possible she'll be in Andor next year for season two. So
please make it happen, Brad. Put it into yeah, the universe. I hope she comes back because she's so interesting. She's so interesting. And she made such an impression with her like two lines in Rogue One. So I thought it was cool to kind of have that character show back up. But also, what time is it? What are we on? What are we on? Bail Watch?
Bail Watch.
Is that Force Times Bail Watch? we were on Bail Watch and Bail did show up. So that was thrilling for me personally. It was probably thrilling for our friend Eric Iverson as well. As well as our friends Travis over at Force Time. I mean,
that's 2 years in a row, baby.
We
2 years
love
in
it,
a row, Bail Organa.
Let's go for the third, the triple threat.
The triple threat.
2024 come through. On
shout
Andor,
out to Phil Lamar as well for voicing Bail Organa back from his appearances in Tales of the Jedi, Clone Wars, Rebels, you name it. He's been voicing Bail for quite some time.
Yes. Yes. So I was excited to get him back because we know, of course, that both Almo and Bail Organa are really fundamental or members of the rebellion. So them coming back and voicing their opinions and being the sort of characters that we know them to be earlier on in the timeline is pretty cool. It's pretty cool. We'd love to see it. So I really enjoyed that as well. And this clone story that we get throughout these episodes is really quite sad because nobody makes it out alive. You know, when you have the cold open and you're like, that character's dead. That's immediately kind of the vibe I got here. And then they both ended up dead. So yeah. I did not catch the first clone's name who died, but the second clone that dies in the second episode is called Slip. So sad, sucks, it's sad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as soon as I saw Slip and the other, I'm also blanking on the name, but that's how quick the other clone died. I was like, well, don't need to remember his name now, unfortunately. As bad as that might sound, I was just like, no thoughts, head empty. As soon as they were having this conversation, I was having flashbacks to Fives and when Fives found out about the chip and and how the Kaminoans and Palpatine were all working against Fives to, you know, he knew the truth about Order 66 and what the chips were designed for. And unfortunately, he couldn't stop it. Right. But it was really satisfying to see Slip still get that information out, critical information, and to live on beyond death, or like have an impact beyond death in a way, right? Like, it doesn't feel like he died for nothing. You know, he stuck to what he felt was right and what he felt was too far, and he didn't want to stay silent any longer, you know. And initially he was resistant, I think, to the other clone who
was
on about this, right? So like, that just goes to show like his willingness to carry on what his friend believed in and also see the truth that was at hand. Like, you know, the conspiracy against the clones of the episode's title, right? Like, the conspiracy is like, we're going to eliminate Kamino, we're going to eliminate the clones, and we're going to do whatever we can to remove them as a dominating force within the galaxy to make way for a new, more powerful, more loyal soldier.
Can we talk about, not to change the topic totally, but I thought of this because of you mentioning the clone to, you know, like other beings switch, that it is intentionally a fear tactic and like an oppression tactic, because it is the Empire exerting control and exerting power over the public and the masses and using the people against themselves. And I think like that is really powerful to like see out loud, if that makes sense. But also just like really, it's loud. It's loud is what it is. They can't control the clones because the clones have no status in society in that sense. Like they can just discard them, but they can control the public even further by conscripting their brothers and sisters and using those same people to oppress them.
The like non-clones of the galaxy, they are like driven by fear and by like survival, whereas like the clones are driven by like following orders, even if it means life or death, essentially. So like it's easier to rule through the former.
Yeah, I mean, yes. And I think also, and you think about like status in society, like the citizens of the galaxy are not necessarily regarding the clones as one of them in a sense. Like it's also a way to use the quote unquote us against the us.
Yes. Okay, I see what you're saying. Yep.
So there's an us versus them, and they're eliminating the them to oppress further the us category.
Right. And then it also buys more senators into the war effort, right? Like if it is a quote unquote like us fighting versus like, you know, an army comprised of the people, right?
Because
according to the senators, the clones are not people, apparently. If the army is actually comprised of people, we will do whatever it takes to help the people, us, instead of them being the clones. And they don't represent us because they don't, you know, whether it's like they don't look like us, they are manufactured genetically, like on a Kamino lab, and they have accelerated aging, like they're different. Right. So like we have to usher in like a new soldier, like the people.
Yeah. And then rule through fear. And yeah. Yeah. Anyway.
I never would have thought when we started this show, like when the show was announced, that we would be dealing with these sorts of questions and like these sorts of big ideas. Like, I just think it's so fascinating. Like, this is why I really love this episode.
It's interesting because we go from like an episode like the last one with Gunji, and it kind of being about home and family and big emotions and the way that war separates people and the way that, you know, the Jedi are flawed in some ways. But ultimately, it's kind of a heartwarming story in the sense that like Gunji gets to go back to his home and be accepted by his people, you know, a village on Kashyyyk. And it's about like big feelings. And then we get to an episode like this immediately afterward, and it's like, it is about the policy and the politics and the pensions and the veterans and the us versus them. And it's such an interesting range that this show captures, and the way that like this episode is not about big feelings at all. And that's okay. Like, you know, neither of these is the wrong way to approach things, but it's so fascinating to me. We're really getting into the nitty-gritty of the political situation. And last episode we were talking about the trees.
You know, the show can do it all, really. Yeah. It's just
part of the reason why I'm like, what are we doing with this show? But at the same time, I'm like, so we were talking about the trees and how the trees have feelings, and you know how they cried and prayed at the trees, and now we're just talking about pensions and defense recruitment bills.
See, like that's the complexity of us as viewers, is like we can really be enjoying everything that has been given to us, like while also asking the question of like, okay, like how is this all tying together in some in some sort of through line or some sort of like larger end goal. Like what is the end goal, especially with a soldier like Crosshair? And I do wonder, now that all of this is out in the open and Rampart, you know, gets arrested, I know we're getting ahead of ourselves, but like, you know, there is a question of now what happens to Crosshair when he has nobody to answer to or nobody to receive orders from,
right?
You know, because Rampart is really the guy who was keeping track of the clones and like what they were doing. So is it like Tarkin who fills that void? We know Tarkin does not like clones troopers. He is going to be 100% support of stormtroopers and like getting them to the front lines, right? So
right,
I wonder if this arc is the flip for Crosshair to go, okay, we are worthless in the eyes of the galaxy. Like, we are following orders and we are not getting anything in return. Like, we are just basically being thrown away. And where is the line for Crosshair going to be drawn, right? So we've seen a lot of clone soldiers drawing those lines, and where is Crosshair's is going to be the big question, I hope, of the second half of the season.
I think I've been thinking so much about the shock and awe I felt when Palpatine completely threw like one of the main architects, Rampart, under the bus that I didn't actually think about what the consequences of that would be. Because I mean, I don't know about you, but like when these episodes started and after episode 3, of course, I think we were both like, wow, Rampart, he's like bad. He's a machination.
He's a bad dude.
There are plans happening here. Like, he has a lot of power that I don't think I quite understood through his appearances in season 1 that he held in the way that he held. So I think after seeing that in episode 3, I really expected him to continue his power trip and his architecture of the Empire and sabotage of the clones throughout the rest of the season. And so I was really shocked to see him be thrown to the wolves in this episode. And I guess that does leave the question, what happens to the clones? What happens to the knowledge about whether the Bad Batch is alive or dead? What happens to Crosshair's role in all this, and what Crosshair feels about his clone-ness and also about the Empire? Because, you know, if we recall from the earlier episode, the reason why Cody leaves is because he kind of goes against order and shoots the governor you know, with not a single ounce of remorse in that moment, because he's following orders. I haven't even thought about Crosshair. I'm really fascinated to find out, and I hope we get like a robust answer for that.
Well, we know clones value like loyalty above all else, so I want to see, does Crosshair value loyalty to the clones over loyalty to like an entity like the Empire, right? Like, what comes first, the clones or your orders?
It seems like it's Crosshair's, been orders lately.
Yeah, for him,
so I guess
for sure.
Will that change?
And I think Cody has realized that it is the clones who come first.
And himself.
Yeah, totally.
You know?
So there's some big things happening. I hope, and I don't want to just get to the finale for those big things to happen too, right? Like,
yeah. As
my one concern is that we, you know, we have several episodes that don't really address those consequences, and I'm sure that there, you know, we will see that. It's just a matter of like how consistently and how in depth. But I want to jump, I guess, to Truth and Consequences now that we're.
Mm-hmm.
Started talking about it, and I mean, Clone Conspiracy is really like a build up to figuring out that there are records on Rampart's Venator that show the proof, you know, the concrete evidence. Rex is back in the picture. He's hiding out in Trace and Rafa's garage, which, you know, he's like, oh, you know, these are my friend's place. They own it. They're out right now.
Oh my God, it's Trace and Rafa.
And you know, it's funny because we saw them, I totally forgot they were in the episode Decommissioned last year, and at the end of that episode they contact Rex, so I was like, oh gosh, I should have seen that coming. But this was such an exciting episode because of just the tension and the sense of sneaking around, and like they could be caught at any moment. Like, this seemed like a really daring mission. Like, I was like, how are they gonna freaking do this? They are in the like capital of the Empire, which, by the way, like, our ship's not getting looked at when they enter like the capital. I would feel like the Bad Batch's ship would be like, that ship is the one we've been looking for. That belongs to Clone Forest 99. They're supposed to be dead, but it's landing on Coruscant. Like, maybe. Who's watching the skies? Cyril Karn would have caught that.
And he would have made some noise about it. He would be banging pots and pans outside everybody's door and be like, come the fuck on, guys. This is happening.
Let's go, people.
Yeah. It's so funny. I'm like, yeah, I lived in DC for a while, and on the corner where I lived, like, there was often a man with a gun who worked for the government because I lived in near government buildings. But then I was thinking to myself, well, Coruscant is a city planet. Like, that's a lot of work.
Oh man, we're getting into like Coruscant geography. Is the whole city cover the entire planet?
Yeah.
Oof.
Yeah, no, okay.
So yes. They can just, I mean, do they just like land somewhere that's like less looked after, and then they like fly across the planet into like the more heavily like guarded, monitored area? Like, it's just crazy to me
not to completely divert into Coruscant geography, but I'm pretty sure the whole city or the whole planet is the city. And also that, like, the only, I mean, this is in the High Republic, like, the only piece of land, capital land, that still exists is like the peak of one of the mountains that has become a garden for the Chancellor.
Right. Yeah, that's in Light of the Jedi.
I love that.
I have to go back now and reread that part of the chapter.
But like, it, yeah. I mean, I guess I never really think about the entire planet as the city, but like, can you imagine? You're like, oh, I got to commute cross town.
But yeah, I am nitpicking here, and I don't actually care. But part of me was like, how did they just land so easily?
That was my thought in one of the racing episode, when I'm like, does people just not care that they're just like walking around in armor? Like, are they not like Empire is oppressing them? Like, the Empire is oppressing them, and they walk around in armor.
I was like primed to be thinking about this because you mentioned that. And now I'm like, oh, we're in like the heart. Cause my excuse was like, oh, maybe they're just like on the outer rim and these are planets that are untouched by the Empire. It's like, no, this is the Empire. Like, Coruscant like is Imperial hub, like the hub of all hubs.
The public is just really not phased. And I say that seriously, yeah. Because like, I feel like we've seen troopers in enough context where like troopers maybe shouldn't be like, also is it on Daimyo, is that the planet in Kenobi where we see clone trooper? But like, he's clearly down on his luck, but that's not some place where you want the Empire to be, where like otherwise, because you know, that's a kind of like a seedy place where you can do whatever you want. And so was this place in the planet in the Bad Batch, which I can't think of the name of. Not very good at this. But I'm like, wait a second. Are they not concerned? But maybe they're just not. Maybe everybody's just minding their own business enough to be like, I'm not concerned. I see the weirdest shit every day.
Like, the it's also the very galaxy. Possible that it's so early in the Empire that like Rampart mentions in the Clone Conspiracy that the threat of insurgency is demanding the need of conscripted soldiers. So like, I think maybe the Empire is at a point where they don't need as heavy of a presence like within the airspace, and like, you know, pulling random ships aside and being like, hey, send us your clearance codes, like, to make sure that you're not like a rebel spy or that you're an insurgent, you know, like Saw Gerrera or like Axis. You know how like what's his face, Luthen, gets caught in Andor just because he's kind of floating in space? And
right,
like, I guess we're maybe not there yet, where it's like the threat of rebellion is not quite as urgent as it's going to be 5 to 8 years from now. So that's probably why that's going to be my headcanon for why they could just kind of.
Weren't there entire episodes in the first season about chain codes?
Yeah, you're right. I don't know anything anymore.
This is incredibly nitpicky, but I'm really just trying to understand the atmosphere of the galaxy. It's really not like me going after the show or anything, but I'm just like, I just want to like get how the people are living, you know?
Especially like the people of Coruscant, like how oppressive is it there? Because when we see it in Andor, it's like so colorless, it looks nothing like it does in these couple episodes, which, by the way, shout out to Coruscant.
Yeah,
I'm so happy we're back.
Shout out to Coruscant. Hell yeah.
You know, we've gotten Coruscant in every show since Kenobi. That's incredible.
We'd love,
I hope,
to
that continues.
It. We
and
love
I think we're get-
to see it.
I think that's going to continue with The Mandalorian. So it does, because it's in the trailer. So we're getting 4 shows in a row with Coruscant. Like, that's
The Acolyte, a High Republic show, has to have Coruscant. That's my hottest
take. Yeah, totally. Yeah, no, it's going to have Coruscant. Yeah. And Andor season 2 will have Coruscant. Yeah.
Coruscantissance.
Let's go. Let's go. Coruscant's here to stay. Okay. We're going to derail a little bit here, but
we've been derailing this whole time. This episode's structure is a little willy-nilly, but you know, we're talking about the stuff, so it's fine.
Yeah.
The things are getting talked about.
What did you think of the hijinks, of the infiltration of the Venator, like all of that action, that sneaking around? How did you feel about it?
So I mentioned at the top 208, I was like, wait a second, why is this show the best when it doesn't feature the Batch? And then like 2 minutes into this episode, the Batch shows up and I was like, wait a second, wow, okay, they're here. They're actually playing a role in this. I was a little shocked. And I didn't find this episode quite as interesting as the Clone Conspiracy. I think I was like, okay, where are we going? It's going to be some action. That's great. Love the action. But it didn't just grab me quite as much as the Clone Conspiracy did. That being said, I think that the Batch, as we mentioned earlier, is like utilized really well here. And I like that they're called up apart from Cid. And I like that everybody's role is pretty clear about what they're doing. And I really like, I mean, I can't say a bad word about Omega. She's just such a precious baby soul. And I think Omega has a great moment in this one. We do get a little bit of the politics with Chuchi kind of being brought in by Bail, and then them connecting with Senator or former Senator Bertoni, a Kaminoan,
yes.
who yep. ended up getting removed. And, you know, Bertoni's like kind of selfish or playing into her own self-interest. And she's like, why do you care? And Omega goes, because I'm a clone too. Like this is important to me because, you know, I'm directly affected by this. And once again, like the heart of the show is Omega. And I think that was once again really clear in that moment as to why the Batch is there and, you know, the role that they're playing. So I thought that was great, and how they kind of tied in with Rex was also awesome. So yeah, I ultimately think that the action was interesting and ultimately led to a really, really thrilling climax too in the political part of it.
It was so cool when the Venator just starts firing up its engines, and I'm like, wait, are they gonna fly that like into space?
I was like,
and
are they gonna crash it into the city?
like what the hell's going on? That was exciting, and like the escape pods, and I love when Tech lands and he's like, ah, I was only off 6 meters or something. He's like,
6.4
meters. He's like, ah, I could have been better, you know.
I was like, I love you.
Shout out to Senator Bertoni as well, another senator from the Clone Wars, specifically also from the episode Pursuit of Peace, which is one of the stories in Stories of Light and Dark,
which
is written by Ann Erso.
I've read that. Yeah, yeah. I knew I recognized her name, but like I couldn't have put that together for you. So thank you so much for putting that together for me. That's a great story.
Yeah. Great, great story. I wish Ann Erso would write more Padme, because that was just a killer story in that anthology. But shout out to Omega in her like senatorial robe that she kind of puts on her. I think it's a poncho, maybe another Star Wars poncho.
We love ponchos.
Has entered the arena, but it was cool to see her and Chuchi just like talking about politics and talking about the Senate and like what its purpose is. Because when you think about it, like Omega hasn't had that exposure to these sort of ideas of like, what does it mean to like debate, and what does it mean to come together and form legislation? Right. So these are all new concepts that she has no baseline for. But I also like want to ask, she walks right past Rampart. Does
they
Rampart not know
right up to like, each other?
Literally, within 6 feet. Like,
and he just doesn't look down at her. Like he just looks at Chuchi.
Have they met before?
I feel like there's no way you can't not know about Omega. She's like a very special.
It's clone. Just so interesting. I'm like, how does he not recognize a clone too? Like, I know Omega is different than the typical clone, but like, it's just really interesting. Because again, my mind was like, how did they just land on Coruscant? And then here I'm like, how does he not know that's Omega? Again, nitpicking. I don't actually care. These are just questions that I had in my mind as I was watching. I was like, wait, is she going to get found out? Like, what's going on here? But yes, I thought it was really cool how every person sort of played their role, and Omega being the one to deliver the plans to Bail Organa,
yes,
which is just so iconic. Omega, Bail Organa sharing a scene together, like, how cool.
Oh my gosh.
And then Bail getting the plans to Chuchi, or the, not the plans, like the records to Chuchi, and then she uses those in the Senate. Like, it was a
and
little game of little game of tag
into the Senate.
That was
the
crazy.
Destruction of Kamino by
that
Rampart.
Was
oh
one
my
of the coolest
God.
Things and like tragic things. They're like one of the coolest things that's ever happened in the Senate on screen. Like a huge hologram. Just oh my gosh.
I just was like, okay, we have this evidence, but is it actually going to be wiped? Like my thoughts were like, is it actually going to be there? Is it actually going to be substantial and interesting? And it was like the footage itself. It wasn't like an audio record of Rampart talking. It was exactly what happened. And you can't deny that evidence. And I thought that was so powerful because Chuchi was really getting herself in some deep shit with these big accusations. I was like, she's putting herself on the chopping block. Like,
right.
You know, we know that some of these senators spoke out, but we also know that like Bail and Mon Mothma at times had to be very careful and very judicious about the things that they were saying because they didn't want to bring too much attention to themselves. And so Bail being like, here's the evidence. I was like, this is loud, buddy. Like, this is really loud for you, you know? so I was surprised about that. But
they were already threatening to remove her from office. Like they put a motion, they started to put the motion in to be like, remove her from the chambers.
Yeah.
If we don't get evidence, like she's just throwing out accusations.
Right. Like that puts everybody in really some hot water and you know, and puts these big voices in harm's way. And so when we see that evidence and our jaws are already on the ground, it's like, oh my God, where do we go from here? And then like the floor opens up and I'm like, holy mother of God, shit.
Like we both knew what was gonna happen, what was about to go down. Like we just knew. We're like, it's Palpatine.
I mean, oh, I really was like, oh, is he gonna get away with this? And then I was like, oh, he's not gonna get away with this. They're gonna get Rampart. And then Palpy, like, he put down the Uno reverse card.
Yeah, oh
he,
yeah.
Like, he was like, reverse.
Like, bitch, you thought we're getting
exactly,
rid of clones.
But like, oh my God. I was so shocked. And of course, and then after the episode ended, I was like, oh my gosh, of course this is all, you know, something that Palpatine can twist. We know he is the man that is 8 steps in front of everybody else at all times, you know, throughout the saga. And that's why it makes him such a great character. It's like, you know, one of those things that like happens on routine or is so in character, but every time it happens, you're still like, wait a second, what? Are you kidding me? Really?
How did they do that?
How did he, what? Like as if it is completely novel, like if it's the first time you're ever experiencing it, like complete shock and awe, even though it's the most predictable thing in the world for the person to show their true colors, you know? And I thought that was so great. And you said it after, you know, we had watched the episode, was that we've gotten 3 iconic speeches, like the trilogy of Palpatine speeches in terms of the way that the Empire has, you know, come to be, changed and solidified itself. And I'll let you take it from here.
Yeah, no, I mean, I was like, holy shit, like, of course, like, this is the third act for Palpatine, like the final kind of piece of his empire puzzle that he needs to put into motion. Like the first speech was the creation of the clone army at the end of Attack of the Clones. Like that's the big speech. He gets the emergency powers. Like that's huge. Then in Revenge of the Sith, we have the first galactic empire, right?
Right.
And in this speech, he says here, I'm going to just read the whole thing here.
Do it.
He says, however, Rampart did not act alone. The fact that the clones under his command so blindly followed orders, inflicting such carnage without hesitation, gives me pause. Perhaps it is time for a change. No, now more than ever, building a strong galaxy requires protection and security. It is my opinion that this legislation is our future. With this momentous act, we shall usher in a new era heralded by the Imperial Stormtrooper. And then that's when we hear Anakin's dark deeds, which is also what played as he lifted both arms in Revenge of the Sith.
Oh my God.
And the Empire came to be and everybody applauded as democracy fell, right? So like the fact that we now get to see that third act of his plan, like I just was like, this is amazing. Like this is incredible that we as Star Wars fans have gotten to see these three iconic, terrifying, to be clear, like horrifying.
Right. Awful. Objectively awful.
Speeches. But like, when you look at the politics of Star Wars and of the Empire and the Rebellion, like these are just such momentous speeches that change the entire galaxy.
Right.
And ironically are also the ones that like this, him doing this is what's going to be the Empire's downfall. Because when you take away soldiers who will blindly follow orders, which like he created soldiers who would do that. Like this was his idea to create the clones in the first place to follow Order 66. And here he is, ironically saying, like, they blindly follow orders. It's dangerous.
I think with that, that brings us to one of the most interesting kind of facets of this two episodes that we haven't actually touched on yet. And that is the clone assassin. And I think we both initially thought that this was Crosshair because there were, you know, we were seeing down the sniper sights. And it turns out that it was literally a numberless clone who ultimately committed suicide by chomping on a poison tooth. And, you know, Rex and co are, you know, looking for more information about this clone, and they find that his number has been wiped. And I don't know what commentary I have on this, but I thought that was a really interesting idea. Clones against one another. What? You're making a face right now, and the audience cannot see this face, but like, let's talk it through.
The gears are turning. A numberless clone. Do we think this is connected to the end of season one where they brought Lama Su to that facility? They're doing something at that place. Remember? Oh. Do we think that they're making more like hybrid clones or like a super soldier, like without a number? And this is one of them.
Well, keeping Lama Su around, they're doing that for a clear reason.
There's some cloning still going on. There is a Kaminoan.
Nefarious actions happening with the clones. And well, I don't know if it's active new cloning or if they are taking clones that they already have and are
enhancing them even more, maybe.
Quote unquote enhancing maybe. Them. You're running medical experiments on them, torturing them, whatever they want to do.
Cause didn't they take the Bad Batch's DNA at one point in season one, like in the first two episodes? Like I just wonder if like Crosshair is being used in any way for this as well. Like
he's because this is a sniper by the Empire.
This is a sniper soldier, right? Like are they taking his DNA to replicate that in other soldiers?
Like creating a serum? I don't like that idea.
I mean, it is a soldier in here who is sniping and like has all of the characteristics of Crosshair, and we think it's Crosshair, right. But it's actually not, right? So like, are they cloning Crosshair's sort of genetic makeup in a way that allows these soldiers to take on his qualities and his skills? That's like my like tinfoil hat theory. I think there's like something very nefarious going on besides the fact that like, oh, it's just like a clone. Like there is something really weird going on here. Totally. And I hope we find out the answers to it at some point. I think it has to do with Lama Su though. That's my guess.
You're probably right. Lama Su will pop back and we'll be like, oh my God, Lama Su, you're alive. because we haven't, you know, of course, seen Lama Su in a while. But
Right.
Wow. Okay, Brad. I'm on board.
Picking up what I'm putting down, you know?
Yeah. I guess I don't know. Why am that? Weird. Okay. I'm concerned.
instead of Crosshair, it's Crosshair, like Luke and Lou.
Oh, okay, thank you. I was like, I'm not getting the joke. yeah, Luke.
Or it's just Crosshairs.
Crosshairs, yeah, with plural. A Z, of course.
Crosshair and the Crosshairs, new band. It's just Crosshair and his clones.
Crosshair and the clones.
Crosshair's got a guitar that looks like a sniper rifle.
Oh yeah, this is great. Let's keep workshopping this. This is a really good idea. Yeah.
Lucasfilm, yeah, call us. If you're not going to put Crosshair in the Bad Batch, we'll find a show for him.
Galactic Idol. anyway.
Where's Crosshair? I need him back. I need my boy back.
He's rehearsing with Crosshair and the clones for Galactic Idol.
Imagine if we didn't see Crosshair the rest of the season.
Don't even look at me. Like, I guess the question is, like, what other plans has Rampart put into motion that we haven't seen yet? And like, how will those continue? Will Palpatine be more involved? Will somebody take his place? I think that's like the big lingering question I have on the Empire side is like, who fills the void that's created in power by Palpatine throwing, you know, him under the bus, which was the move in order to save face and continue along with his agenda.
I think it's Tarkin.
You think, I mean, that would make sense. But it's kind of the Krennic of it all. It's the, you stand on my achievements. The way that, you know, Krennic is like, is totally used in the creation of the Death Star. I feel like Rampart's getting some similar treatment, although I fear Rampart actually a lot more than I fear Krennic. Krennic was a little bit whiny.
Yeah. Also, I do want to specifically say it was Mount Tantus that I was referring to, which was originally introduced by Timothy Zahn in Legends, but it was confirmed to be Mount Tantus in the show notes on StarWars.com last year. But in Legends, it was like Palpatine's secret storehouse where he had like, you know, a bunch of where cloning cylinders. And yeah, that's where they took Lama Su. Mm. So like, it's where they basically house a lot of cloning technology. So
gotcha.
Something is going on. Something's rotten in the state of Mount Tantness. Tantus.
Wow. The word is just not happening. But I got to make the joke or else. Do you think that's where the sneaks were? Sneaks equipment maybe? Is located
potentially maybe or, you know, Snoke, is this sneaks. Was the sniper clone a Snoke? Who knows? We'll never know.
I think I'm gonna go cry in a corner now. I hate that joke. I hate the implication of that joke.
You know, the funny thing is that like that could actually be a like, thing. Who
that's
knows
why.
Who
that's
knows?
Why I'm crying in the corner. That's why.
You know, like the conspiracy theorist in me was like, you know, Andy Serkis did come back. Did he film more Snoke scenes? While he was on Andor, did he film more Snoke scenes, Andy Serkis?
His various Snoke personalities, a group of sneaks.
And like, part of me does wonder too, like there is cloning in The Mandalorian. So like, does this connect to The Mandalorian in some way? I don't know. I don't know. We're really going to go off the deep end here, but there is a lot of cloning like just happening in Star Wars in general, I feel like.
Like,
it's very interesting.
Way too much cloning. With all due respect to Star Wars and clones, but like there's so much cloning happening, like way more than is like, socially acceptable.
George Lucas like 20 some years ago was just like, hey, wouldn't it be cool if the clones, they're just a bunch of clones?
Yeah. Wouldn't it be cool if it were all clones?
He's like, that seems cool. And now everyone's like, everything's gonna be a clone.
Snoke, clone. Anyway.
Oh my god.
Too many clones.
I want to cry. It's fine. It's fine.
Anyway, do we have anything else to say about these episodes?
Yeah, speaking of too many clones, let's go back to the Bad Batch where there are just quite too many clones. But now there's going to be one less clone, so not actually as many clones. We're losing Echo.
Bye,
Echo's
Echo.
Leaving, going to hang out with Rex and
to be clear,
follow his
purpose. I still have two dogs and one of them is named Echo and he hasn't gone anywhere.
True. Not going anywhere. Good. Yeah.
He's doing okay.
I guess we've alluded to it quite a bit and like, you know, we're not sure if he's going to be written out of the show, which I don't think will happen, but you know, we might have some time apart from him. I guess we've already talked about this a little bit, but I just do think that was an emotional note to end on, and you know, seeing Omega kind of hug her toy at the end and in her cockpit room. I wonder how this is going to affect her for episodes to come. And like, I just wonder how the dynamic's going to change and like when the batch is going to decide that running and taking jobs is just simply not enough for their existence anymore.
Right.
And that they are meant to do something much more that helps people like them, people who are clones and who need the help, because they're clearly not getting it from the Senate. They are not getting it from the Empire. You know, Chuchi can try as hard as she wants, but the odds are really stacked in her favor representing the clones, especially not being one herself. Like, no offense, but like, I think that's going to be a little bit of an obstacle for her to overcome, to be like, you know, why do you care so much? You know, we're not going to listen to you. The clones are going to be discarded. She's got a lot. She's got a big battle to face, you know? I don't think it'll be enough. I think we need people like Rex and like Echo who are out in the galaxy, like helping to really liberate them and give them new lives outside the Empire.
Yeah, I think with, you know, the batch itself and the question of like what propels them, I think Omega's pain in this moment, her kind of grief at losing Echo in this moment, might be a thing that propels her to, as she always does, show her big heart to, you know, Hunter and Tech and Wrecker, and propel them to the positive action, the right action. So I could see kind of her nudging them continuously, because she's like, well, if Echo is taking this path, then we should do something just as meaningful, is kind of my thought in all that.
I totally agree with you there. I think Omega will be the next one to make that request, or to be the devil's advocate of like, what are we doing?
Mm-hmm.
It's bound to happen. I do hope it happens by the end of the season, and maybe real end game of the show could be, okay, like once they figure out enough running, let's help clones. Like, who is the first clone that is like the obvious choice to help liberate would be Crosshair. And then maybe a season three is like, let's rescue Crosshair from himself and like from the cycle that he's like found himself in. Like, I was really hoping that was going to be this season, and it still could be in the tail end. We're halfway through now. I'm not totally hopeful on that, but I could be proven wrong.
Right.
I would like to be proven wrong. I really hope Crosshair becomes a larger player in these last couple episodes. Last eight episodes, I should say, not couple. There's like a whole half a season left to go. So, which is good.
Like,
I'm excited.
Maybe we're thinking that way because we're like, oh, well, we are only doing a couple more episodes as we recap them.
But right.
No, there's
right.
actually a lot of episodes to watch still. So
yeah. Next time on the podcast, we're doing our, what is it, like six episode extravaganza.
Yeah, unless we watch them and we're like, oh no, we can't do all six in one go.
Which could happen.
We did seven in one go for Resistance once. We can do anything.
Yeah, that's true. I'm excited though. We've been kind of watching them in like smaller chunks because we watched like three in a row, and then we watched like two in a row, and now we get to watch six in a row, which is like, oh, so many Bad Batch episodes to go through. And then we don't have the screeners for the finale, so we'll have to wait along with everybody else for that one.
My question for you is like, does this season feel like it's going fast so far? Because like, I feel like we're almost flying by.
I think it does, just because we've happened to see the episodes like earlier than the
but I also
schedule.
Think that like having two parts,
also that yes
you know yeah. like I think that kind of really
it's 3 weeks right there
moves yeah. us forward in terms of the numbers much quicker than if they were all one episode per week.
Yeah, no, I that might be also due to like the Mandalorian and how much they want that to cross over and with Celebration and all
oh
of that
gosh.
Stuff. So,
oh my gosh, so
oh my
much coming up on
gosh.
The schedule. Good Lord.
Yes, it's a lot. It's a lot. But yeah, I guess that's all for now on the Bad Batch. Did you have any other final thoughts on these two episodes before we close out?
I don't think so. Any final thoughts on those two episodes? I think my final thought, as always, is, you know, we'll include links in the description to conversations and resources regarding Unwhitewash the Bad Batch. it remains, as I said in our last episode, a valuable conversation and one that we want to continue to bring attention to. So please check out those resources if you haven't already and join the conversation.
As Sarah mentioned, we only have a couple episodes left to cover The Bad Batch, even though there are 8 left. But that's kind of been our focus right now. We're taking a little bit of a breather before the upcoming kind of Star Wars celebration, Mando, High Republic, Phase 2,
Onslaught.
Wave 2, Jedi Battle Scars, Jedi Survivor Onslaught that is going to
attack.
Wreck us.
Yeah.
Like, yeah,
keep us
go for
very
the,
busy.
Go for the throat for like 2 months straight. We were like, let's cover The Bad Batch in bits so we can have more room for other episodes. We're like, wait, no, we like the extra free time before we have to really capital W work on some stuff. But yeah, in the meantime, we do have a lot of cool things coming up. So if you're a High Republic fan, Battle of Jedha will be out very, very soon. Jedi Survivor did get delayed a month. So we will still be covering Battle Scars, though, in the month of March. So some fun discussions to be had there. And then you and I just received a Cataclysm advanced review copy, which is like crazy because it's
happening
2 months away. That book is coming out. So I'm going to get right on that because I want to see what Axel Greylark's up to in prison. But so much to hear from us here on the podcast. Make sure you're following us wherever we are on social. So that includes Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Facebook, Hive, you name it. Sarah and I are also on many of those platforms, including Twitter, Letterboxd, Goodreads, and Instagram. So you can follow us there and see what we're doing. And also, if you enjoyed the episode, subscribe so all of our future stuff drops in your feed. And leave us a 5-star written review if you could, if you enjoyed the episode. It really helps other folks find the show, and it makes us feel good, which is always a good thing.
We also have a Patreon. We're tiers start at just $1, and we really are grateful for our patrons. I know we say this every single time, but it is so true. Thank you for help making the show happen week to week, and thank you for tuning in and listening. Thank you to everybody who takes time out of their day to listen to us yap about Star Wars. It means a lot. And we're glad that we can be part of your Star Wars conversations.
Yeah, totally. So that is all for this week. We will see you next time. And until then, may the Force be with you always.
Bye.